If you're looking for filters, you came to the wrong place. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean.
Began with a small disorganized protest on Wall Street in Lower Manhattan here in New York, has grown to demonstrations nationwide.
Filter Free Radio, live every Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern, on the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, Radio or Not, and filterfreeradio.com.
Occupy Wall Street protesters identify themselves as the 99% that will no longer tolerate the greed and corruption of the 1%.
If you kill Wall Street, there'll be nobody else to create jobs. Wall Street is Main Street. That's all we do in Wall Street. We finance companies. And companies are people.
There seems to be no turning back as demonstrators express their outrage at what they call the injustices of the U.S. economic system.
Occupy Wall Street! All day, all day.
But what exactly is their message?
I hope that the system changes towards inclusion. And that's it. And that's what I love about this so far, is that people are peaceful, they're respectful, and that it seems to come from a place of love. And that's where you want to be.
Do not fuck this up! We welcome them with love and respect.
We welcome them with love and respect.
Revolutions are not made on protests. Protests are simply demonstrating. Revolutions are made by seizing power, seizing control, and seizing power. And the way you do that is by making real demands and agitating for them.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the very first broadcast live from Portland, Oregon, of Filter Free Radio. So good to be with you. I'm Jacob Dean. Alongside me is our fantastic, super duper awesome mass producer, live from Washington, D.C. on the East Coast, Mr. Skeptical Scott.
Hello.
Hello. Let me bump up your level there a little bit, bud. All right.
Thank you.
So good to be with you. Wow, it's been a while, friends, and thanks for tuning in to filterfreeradio.com. We're also broadcasting live on the home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com, and also syndicated by the good folks over at progressiveblendradio.com, DJ Downtown on the More Me Show. Thank you so much, however you are joining us, wherever you may be. It is so good to be back with you live again. This is the new studios of Filter Free Radio. I hope everything is working as well as it looks like it is out there. How you doing, Scott?
I'm hanging in there, man. How you doing?
Oh, doing good. It's great to be back on the air. You know, if you're off the air for longer than a couple of weeks, I think we were off for over a month, maybe 5 weeks. wow, you want to get right back on and get back into the swing of things as soon as you can. Unfortunately, I am a little bit under the weather, so if I sound a little funky coming to you, my apologies. That's not your computer. That's my voice.
Sound great, actually, man. You don't sound like you're sick at all.
Oh, thanks, buddy. A little bit under the weather. I've got a throat lozenge and some ice water on standby, so I'm doing actually really well. And I just want to get right into the show. There's so much to talk about. And again, Scott, thanks for coming on, bud. It's always good to talk with you. We haven't talked in a while. Life kind of happened. I'm back in Portland, which is my home. I've been in, of course, in Washington, D.C., working with the Tom Hartman program and on Filter Free Radio with Scott from Nation Capital. But Scott is still going to be able to join us live from inside the Beltway. Actually, Scott, now you can broadcast live from a undisclosed location outside of the Beltway, but right next to, still in Washington, D.C.
No, I'm inside the Beltway.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just outside of D.C., that's all.
I was actually outside the Beltway, where I was. Anyway, yeah. It's kind of cool to do this bi-coastal, too, being live in Portland, where it's only 4 o'clock in the afternoon, whereas normally I'm looking at this, it's 7 o'clock on the East Coast.
It's 7 o'clock. Not going to lie, it's late.
And it's been a busy day, of course. The Tom Hartman program opened up today with a really interesting thing, and I thought this was really awesome, and I wanted to definitely mention this and at least play this for you, or a little bit of it, which I edited together from the first segment. Tom opened his program today with Shano, who, if you heard, or of course you've heard, I haven't, life happened, and over the course of the last 3 or 4 weeks, the move to Portland, I haven't been able to follow the news as closely as I have been in the past, but catching up on a few things today, big happenings at the Supreme Court. A lot of people have been talking about this. I'm not going to get too much into this, because our good friend Adam, who's doing a new show on Saturdays, Mic Check Radio, Adam from the chat room, Saturdays 6 to 9 Central Time. It's on Ustream, Mic Check Radio on Ustream. And go nice. Check it out. Yeah, he's going to be digging into this, and he played me a little clip, Scott, earlier. It's hilarious. I'm not going to give any more away other than he used one of my favorite movie quotes of all time to make this awesome jingle, and it's going to be really funny. So I want you to check that out. And he's going to get more into this whole thing on the SCOTUS. Shana was at the Supreme Court when this happened, reporting live in Washington, D.C. He came back and was on the air with Tom when Tom went on live on the air.
Yeah, Shane's got his press credentials now.
And how awesome is that? That is so awesome. And I want to play this, which I listened to the interview. Shane did amazing. Pardon me. Shane did amazing on air. He totally, rocked it. And he said one thing that really stood out to me, a couple things that really stood out to me. And I just want to play this for you. And I just get hats off to Shane on the Tom Hartman program today, live at the Supreme Court while this was happening.
It's so frustrating, too, as someone who tends to, when I see public speakers, I tend to yell back, especially at my television. If someone, if I were to say a word, I'd be cuffed and out of there.
Sure.
So you have to sit there and be very quiet as they're pretty much, speaking from the mount, it seems.
Yeah.
This was a political attack going after the president for his new immigration law, saying, see, this is why Arizona needs this law, because of what President Obama's doing. Now I know why the Supreme Court doesn't want cameras, because they would have a lower approval rating than Congress.
Seriously.
That's what I think.
Why?
Really. Because if people really knew what really went on and how those justices act, at least I've only seen them once, and it was today, and I was amazed at the...
Behaving like children?
Just rude. Just nasty, even.
Really?
Yeah. I found Alito very off-putting.
Huh.
Very off-putting, and he sits right next to Justice Kagan, who had just read the opposite side, the majority opinion.
Right.
And he went right after her.
Wow.
Not personally, but on her intellect, at least.
I thought that was definitely at least a filter-free moment to share with you. I don't know, Scott, I know your take.
Yeah, I mean, the Supreme Court's corrupt. What are you going to say? I mean, these guys are hacks.
Right.
Judge Roberts was put in by Bush, and in the typical fashion, when you become a chief justice of the Supreme Court, it's over time. You're not instantly put in as chief justice. And so, since the Robert Court has been in session, whatever, I think the number is 67 or 68% of the time they've sided with the Chamber of Commerce and business and against the people. And so it just speaks to the hackishness of them, and the fact that they're acting like petty school children, and it's just, it's a little elitist club, and these guys are a little, I think someone coined the phrase that they're like the royal family. They're nominated for life, and they sit there and they rule, as if some sort of royalist would do. And so it's really kind of disgusting, the elitism that comes with the position that they're in, and compound that with the fact that these guys are, I would argue, certainly in most cases, at least for Alito, Scalia, and Roberts, and Thomas, God, Clarence Thomas, they're just not qualified for the job, and so they're just hacks, and they're up there with petty bickering and passing and rulings on what they see fit in terms of, their corporate buddies and their rich friends. It's really just disgusting.
Yep, corrupt. Boil it down to corrupt. And I want to talk a little bit about Occupy a little bit later in the program, and how one of the main successes of Occupy, and how Occupy was more or less an idea, a means, not rather an ends, and we'll explain that a little bit in the program a little bit further on. It exposed the corruption in the Supreme Court. Occupy helped expose the corruption in the political system in general, and in the corporate system. A lot of that came and helped, you know, grow the Occupy movement, because it came, it was like a circular feeding. It fed off of itself, and it was great. We'll talk more about that. Also, you know, we're talking about corruption. We're talking about more or less a rigged system. I want to talk about the NBA Finals a little bit, and how corrupt, or was that rigged? I have a take on that. Is it morality?
You want to analogize the NBA and politics? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. How is the NBA Finals like the political system, or just about any other system today? You want morally, you want the underdog to win, the team that, you know, didn't even exist 3 years ago. You know, it's your David versus Goliath kind of situation. And you want the underdog to win because you know that feels right, or at least that's the kind of sports fan I am. I always want to pull for the underdog. For some reason that makes me feel better, you know, to see the underdog win.
Well, it's not your home team either. I mean, if you lived in Miami, you'd obviously be rooting for LeBron.
Well, of course. Of course. But I'm also saying, you know, or do you know in the back of your mind, even though that's what you want and what you feel you want, do you know in the back of your mind what is eventually going to win? The money. Always the money. You know, you look at elections, a lot of people are there's a great saying going around, I think Dylan Radigan coined it, they're not elections, they're auctions. The candidate or side that spends the most money wins 94% of the time. I think that's the statistic.
I thought it was 100%, but still, that's a lot.
I mean, 90th percentile, 94%. That's a solid A in school. I want to talk about that. How the two systems, the NBA or, you know, just for example, not to pick on them specifically. I'm a basketball fan. I'm a big Trailblazer fan. Here in Portland, grew up a big Trailblazer fan. I've got a autographed Trailblazer T-shirt directly above me on the ceiling for soundproofing, which is kind of cool. but I want to compare that a little bit later. And Scott's kind of a basketball fan. And so we'll get into that.
Kind of. Yeah, I'm a freaking fanatic, man. That's all I watch. Basketball's my favorite sport. I mean, I played basketball up until I got too fat to do it. So, yeah, I love basketball.
There we go. And, you know, the other thing that you brought up, Scott, that I want to talk about also a little bit in the program, just kind of previewing everything coming up, and then I'm going to get to a big special guest coming up at the top of the next hour I want to talk about for a minute. But just previewing the things. The other thing that you brought up, Scott, I want to talk about. How do you pronounce his name again? Because you can say it, and I'm going to butcher it.
Say it again.
The philosopher, who?
Oh, Slavoj Žižek.
Yeah, Slavoj
Žižek.
Yeah. And this point about how? Well, do you want to tease that real quick?
Sure. I mean, I'm not sure which aspect that you're talking about.
Well, it's like he's talking about the only voice of
that's right.
Discontent.
Well, that's one of his, and he's not the only one. I've heard this from multiple places, like Noam Chomsky and Cornel West and Chris Hedges, and in general, and the general understanding is, if you look around and you talk to people, people are pretty disenfranchised with not just Barack Obama. He's more of a symbol than anything. I don't even like to personalize it to any one particular person. But, you know, the Democratic Party in general, and just the infrastructure of our government that's supposed to obviously represent the people, and clearly that's not happening. And so people are discontented. You know, it's understood, it's well understood that the Democrat, that the Republican Party, rather, has always represented interests of business. You know, they're always, the right wing is by definition not conservative at all. It's more of a just a corporatist party and a party of wealth and power and privilege. And so the Democratic Party has always, at least up until Bill Clinton, been some sort of a stalwart or at least a buffer, if you will, between that sort of, I guess, I want to say totalitarian rule or just sort of malicious greed, you know, and sort of doing something they can to represent the people at least a little bit. Well, those days are over. You know, there's no one representing the people in government, and certainly not the Democratic Party, and much less the Republican Party, obviously. So you have two parties, one's corporate light, if you will, which is even generous. I think they're both just pretty heavy corporatists. I would say one's a fascist party, being the GOP, and the other one's just a corporatist party, being the Democratic Party. And so with that, people are pretty discontented. And the sad thing is at this point, is there's no one out there to voice that discontent with the system, with the Democratic Party, or with the so-called left, if you will, other than the right wing and Fox News. They're the only ones, you know, bitching about how screwed up and weak the Democratic Party is. And I would posit, and numerous other people have, that there has to be criticism of the left. I'm sorry, let me rephrase that. Criticism of the Democratic Party and the so-called corporate left, if you will, power structure from the left. In other words, providing a third narrative, because right now people don't know really what's going on. They know things not working. They know it's not broken. They know no one represents their interests, but no one's articulating that other than Fox News. And you know, for all their faults, some of their criticism is accurate. However, their rationale for it and their solutions for it are completely corrupt. And so it's important to have a reestablishment of the left and to reemerge as a critic of the structure, of the political structure, of the Democratic Party from the left. And in doing so, what that'll give us is obviously a third narrative, but it's also able to voice people's discontent from a liberal perspective and not from the right.
Bingo.
Which is all that's out there right now. And once that happens, I think people will actually start to realize, oh my God, it's worse than we thought.
Push left.
Exactly. Instead of pushing back against the right, you have to push left.
Push left.
That's what the right. Yeah, that's what the right wing has done.
If that kind of topic interests you, you're going to want to stick around for the entire second hour of the program. Coming up at the top of the next hour, 5 o'clock West Coast. That would be 8 o'clock on the East Coast. The author, blogger, and activist David Swanson is going to drop by for a lengthy conversation on these topics and more. I am stoked.
Awesome.
We had him
on once before briefly, and the conversation was too brief.
I believe we had spoken, correct me if I'm wrong, someone in the chat room, which I should open here.
That's right. We were on Kenny's show.
It was on Kenny Pick's show. And we very briefly spoke with David, and that's how I ended up getting his contact info, which was nice. And thank you, Kenny, for that. David is going to be joining us for about a half an hour, maybe more. Of course, he's the author of
The Crossover.
Whoopsie, sorry about that. He is the author of several books, including Daybreak, which is Daybreak, Undoing the Imperial Presidency and Forming a More Perfect Union. Pardon me while I take care of this really quick so we don't get any more ads playing on there. Again, my apologies for that.
Was screwing me up earlier too.
Sorry about that, buddy. Jacob's box is hot. Careful there, buddy. All right, Adam in the chat room. It's good to see you, buddy, and it's good to see everyone else out there in the chat room. If you're listening to us and you're not in the chat room, you can just log in and check us out. Let's see, where were we? Oh, with David Swanson. Yeah, my apologies.
David Swanson, yeah. His most notable book is War is a Lie.
Right.
He also wrote the book When the World Outlawed War, and another book is Daybreak. I can't read that. The Imperial Presidency and Forms of a More Perfect Union.
Yeah.
Undoing the Imperial Presidency.
Yeah.
So he's an activist and a good one, so I'm excited to have him on.
His website's davidswanson.org is where all of that information and more is. Of course, warisacrime.org. And he's a blogger and works with rootsaction.org. Check it all out. And he's going to be with us in 40 minutes from now at the top of the next hour. And if you're just joining us in the podcast, you can just skip to the one-hour mark on the podcast and listen to that with David. In the meantime, we've got about 10 minutes before the break. And one of the things that I want to get into is I haven't read this week's article by Chris Hedges over at truthdig.com. I will admit,
it's a long one.
It's a long one. And I printed it out, and I got busy doing a couple of other things, promoting tonight's show, and did some other reading into David Sirota filled in for Randy Rhoads today and opened with what Jimmy Carter was talking about, and that really piqued my interest. Cool. And so I got awesome. I got sidetracked from the Chris Hedges article. But what I did do is cover in-depthly the previous article from last week, June 18th, titled Occupy Will Be Back. I have been kind of contacted by a couple of different friends of mine who have been interested in me writing a column or a weekly blog. And I am so thrilled about this opportunity, and I'm definitely going to head and move forward with it. And I started with a blog that I wrote last night. I posted it on filterfreeradio.com. It's also, we will be syndicated, or it will at least be syndicated for the time being, on usaprogressive.com, Ray Medeiros' site. It's on the front page right now. Awesome, Ray. Thank you very much, buddy. And soon, coming to forfreedomsblog.com with Rain and Bob. So I'm excited, very excited about this. And what I wanted to write about in my first attempt to write a blog was a kind of explain a story that I had, and I wanted to take a couple minutes and tell this story tonight because it really shook me. And this is the purpose behind the blog that I wrote, and you can go read it, of course, after the show. But I was talking with a friend. I got back into Portland. I've been driving around, taking care of errands, doing things. And I've seen a few yard signs, probably less than half a dozen, driving around the entire city. Very, very few. But I've seen a few yard signs. And, of course, it's politics season, so everyone's got a yard sign out there that says vote for, you know, average Joe, or vote for Joe Average, you know. And but there's a couple of them that say we are the 99%, and they really caught my eye because I we've got a brand new studio here, and I've got some rather white space behind me that we want to fill up, and we can talk a little bit about that later. I wanted to get one of those signs and find out where I could get one. I've contacted Occupy Portland. I'm waiting to hear back from them. And I'm looking forward to getting involved with Occupy Portland, occupyportland.org. They've got a lot going on, and I'm really excited to be finally able to kind of dive back in and get back into the swing of things.
Get out there and get active, baby.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. I'm excited.
Talk is cheap.
Don't talk about it. Be about it. I love it. And so I come back and I see a few of these signs, and I'm having a conversation with a former coworker of mine, and I'm asking him where, if he knows I could find a couple of these signs, I'd like to get a couple. And the response was insane to me. Said, "Oh, isn't that over with yet? The Occupy thing," more or less, the words to that effect, "isn't that Occupy thing over?" And I'm like, I was speechless. Occupy over? I didn't even really respond. I was like, okay, no worries, man. We'll talk to you later or something. And I was just, whoa. And that's been with me. That was probably Friday. That's been with me for the last 3 or 4 days, and I really wanted to write about it and talk about it. And then, of course, Chris Hedges last week wrote this brilliant piece titled Occupy Will Be Back on Truth Dig. And that just blew my mind. He talks about, you know, kind of the puppet versus the puppeteers, how the people who have the biggest microphones out there, the ones that everyone listens to in the corporate state, obviously serve the corporate state. They are the puppeteers, and they are encouraging us to focus our energies on the puppets, you know, gossip, trivia, personal narratives of the candidates. And they, I'll just read it from you. I've got the article in front of me. Awesome work by Chris Hedges. They spin these silly, useless stories from the left or the right while ignoring the egregious assault by corporate power on the citizenry. I mean, and then he goes on to say, don't waste your time watching or listening. They exist to confuse you and demoralize you. And I've been saying for the last couple of weeks, I thought this analogy was kind of cool. It's simply the puppets and the puppeteers. The puppeteers are hidden, and their goal, their job, they solely exist to distract you, more or less. And that's what
we have a shadow government.
Yeah. And controlled by, you know, all of these different influences, significantly, of course, financial influences, money. We have a Citizens United world now, and the game has been on, you know, and that's why I titled the blog, The Writing is on the Wall, you know, kind of like, hello, the writing's right there on the wall. And
yeah, it speaks to the need of a third narrative. I mean, the only so-called left, if you will, that people understand is out there is MSNBC, and that is not the left. That is corporate America. You know, they are Democrats at best, and certainly not left, if you will, in terms of the left-right paradigm. So, yeah, there's a definite need to fill the void, and the scary thing is if someone doesn't step in to fill that void of the gap, you know, the gap that opens up between reality and people's, I guess, expectations or understanding of the world. As that gap gets wider and wider, people become more and more disenfranchised and disempowered, and they're looking for explanations and answers. And the fear is that they'll turn to some sort of demagogue like Fox News or, you know, or God forbid, some sort of fascist like Mitt Romney. I mean,
propaganda.
Yeah, it's just propaganda. And so the important thing is to remember is propaganda is not ideology. The crap you hear coming from the corporate media, it doesn't matter if it's CNN, MSNBC, Fox, or whatever. It's just propaganda. It's not. They don't express ideologies. They express the paradigm, the narrative that corporate America wants you to think about, wants you to believe you live in. But that's not reality.
No.
And more people are disenfranchised and demoralized because the answers that they're getting don't add up to the questions of what's wrong. And so it's just, you know, you become more and more just demoralized and think, oh, God, things are so bad, no one's going to help us.
Well, and then Chris Hedges goes on in the article to talk about just that, Scott, the gap between our expectations and the reality. And when that particular gap between what we expect from just an average Joe, what used to be the middle class life, to what is now reality, that particular, I think, threshold has been well, you know, investigated on and looked into and written about. And Chris Hedges, again, writes a little bit about that in, you know, in this article. He writes, the engine of all protest movements rests not in the hands of the protesters, but the ruling class. If the ruling class responds rationally to the grievances and injustices that drive people into the streets, then a mass movement can be diluted. Under a rational ruling class, one that responds to demands of the citizenry, you know, it becomes, once the system becomes a servant of the interests of the corporate elites, former political power thwarts justice rather than advances it. It is some brilliant, deep stuff. And we can get into that a little bit more when we come back from the break. here at the bottom of the hour. It's so good to be back with you live on Filter Free Radio, also on RadioOrNot.com, the home of Nicole Sandler, and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com, home of the More Me Show with DJ Downtown. So good to be with you. Also on our website, FilterFreeRadio.com. Don't go anywhere, Scott. And I will be right back. And coming up in just 30 minutes, we'll be speaking with author, blogger, and activist David Swanson. Don't go anywhere. Filter Free Radio. We'll be right back.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
To know which way the economic winds are blowing, just check such newspaper headlines as these: underemployed and underpaid, shrinking consumers, economy leaving lost generation. This devastating economic hurricane is not the natural product of market forces, as the financial elite want us to believe. Rather, it's a direct hit from the ethos of plutocratic greed that now prevails among a cabal of our country's corporate and governmental decision makers. They keep putting the short-term selfish interests of the few over the future well-being of America's many. National interests be damned. Another recent headline offers a galling example of this short-sighted avarice in action. China takes tech tips from Silicon Valley. The story behind the headline is that Chinese officials have launched a crash program to zoom their country into the lead of the world's knowledge economy by surpassing our country as the entrepreneurial innovator and owner of the high-tech future. And guess who's helping them make this great leap forward over the USA? Our own venture capitalists, corporate executives, and university officials. That's who. You might recall that only a dozen years ago, America's middle-class workers were told not to worry about the offshoring of their good-paying manufacturing jobs because their future lay in the new knowledge-based economy. As we now see, that was a lie, for Silicon Valley itself is presently hightailing it to China. This is Jim Hightower saying, chasing quick profits for themselves, U.S. firms are transferring our technical knowledge, competitive edge, and middle-class future nearly 7,000 miles away from us. Why is this crass betrayal of America's workaday families not even being talked about in this year's elections? To help raise hell, go to AmericanManufacturing.org.
To get more of Jim Hightower's populist take on what Wall Street and Washington are up to, visit www.hightowerlowdown.org.
Unfiltered truth, news, and opinion. Filter-free radio.
Look at things how they really are and talk about things how they really are, and maybe we can really solve some really serious problems with real solutions. You just simply start talking about it, and then you start thinking about it, and then we're thinking about something that could bring about a real solution or a real change to really benefit a whole bunch of people rather than a reality TV show that is as relevant as gossip on the Jersey Shore.
Filter-free radio, Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. Radio or not, and filterfreeradio.com.
You never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to the Nicole Sandler Show at radioornot.com.
Your view is not being represented in this country because all of our views have been corrupted by money and politics. Remember, 94% of the time, the candidate who raises the most money wins.
That's the fact that we need to drive home constantly. It's all about the money. Dylan Radigan, you rock.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at radioornot.com.
Are you living in a progressive talk void? If so, be sure to visit leftwingradiostations.com. The state-by-state listing is a quick and easy way to find any left-wing talk radio station across America, from sea to shining sea. Your progressive talk nirvana is only a click away at leftwingradiostations.com. Be sure to like Left Wing Radio Stations on Facebook and share it with your friends. leftwingradiostations.com. United we stand.
Come experience the next generation of progressive voices weekday nights on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at RadioOrNot.com. Liberate yourself with Filter Free Radio, hosted by Jacob Dean every Monday night.
It's just the system is broken. Bring it down. Bring it all down, right?
On Wednesday nights, take a sharp progressive turn and join Talking Left with Danielle and Shano.
All those Republicans are anti-capitalist.
All of a sudden. Well, no, they're just anti-Romney.
Exactly.
and it's interesting to watch the three-legged stool splinter.
Then let it all hang out both Tuesday and Friday nights on Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
You love the Constitution so much, but you hate the government, but you love the corporations. Where does that come from?
Tune in to the primetime Radio or Not lineup weekday nights at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, RadioOrNot.com.
I'm sorry, I just find the whole thing so ironic and so mind-bending, it's just ridiculous.
Unfiltered truth, news, and opinion. Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean. Live every Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. Radio or not. And filterfreeradio.com.
Well, the numbers ain't so good, so we gotta do everything we can.
Ideas aren't good or bad. They're just free.
I probably shouldn't have given this place 5 stars on Yelp.
Is this real life?
Shut up, shut up. This is the most fun I had.
I'm sick of watching Fox. Let's get some fresh air.
And welcome back to Filter Free Radio, our very first broadcast from Portland, Oregon. And of course, our super fine mass producer, awesome co-host, Mr. Skeptical Scott, is with us live from Washington, D.C. on the East Coast.
Hello.
Hello. I got to get that in my box now, Scott.
You got a box? Nice.
Nice. All right. I want to give a quick special mention and a very special happy birthday to Carmen, my sweetheart. Happy birthday. She let me broadcast tonight, so that's my gift.
Oh my God, it's her birthday?
Today is her birthday, so happy birthday, Carmen. And aww. I think she's out in the chat room. And I also want to give a quick shout out to everyone else who's out in the chat room. If you're listening to us live, come in to the chat room on Ustream, Radio or Not. Links are all over the place. Adam and Can Surfer, Honey Bunny. Hey, I think that's Carmen. And I'm in there, Scooter and Snork Y2K, Vic, Will from Chicago. There are a few guests. Tom, of course, from Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick. Tuesdays and Fridays. Tom Shave Schaefer is in the house. Hey, everyone. So good to be back with you live again. We will be live Mondays, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. Same time, same place. And for those of us on the West Coast, the afternoon show, 4 to 6 p.m. Or wherever you may be. I know Central Time. Adam, you're always an hour off, so I'm sorry, but wherever you may be, find your local time. We were talking about Chris Hedges before the break. I want to quickly wrap that up, and we'll talk about, excuse me, still kind of getting out of the woods here on a cold, so bear with us this evening. I've got throat lozenges
and straight up sick, dude, don't lie.
Ice water standing by. I am sick. Sick as a dog or not, we're going to do a live program. I'm just itching to get back on the air and be with you. And coming up in just about 20 minutes, we'll be speaking with author, blogger, and activist David Swanson, davidswanson.org, DavidSwanson, just like it sounds, davidswanson.org for more info. He's going to be with us in 20 minutes for a long-form discussion on more or less where we are today and what the heck do we do about it.
Solutions.
Unfiltered. And something that Scott has been talking about, a third narrative. How about a Green Party vote? I don't know. David might talk about that tonight. I'm excited. We've been talking about Chris Hedges' new article, which led me to write a new blog, which I will be putting out a new blog every week on filterfreeradio.com. It will be syndicated by Ray Medeiros at usaprogressive.com and Bob and Rain at forfreedomsblog.com. How exciting. The very first blog is up now. The writing is on the wall. And I wrote that kind of as my response, or not really response, but as my, for what my two cents is worth, adding into what kind of Chris Hedges was talking about. Chris Hedges wrote this, and I'm going to read this, and this is what totally sparked me on what I wrote as far as my first attempt to write the blog. He says, quote, from truthdig.com, Occupy will be back, quote, our dying corporate class, corrupt on obscene profits and indifferent to humane suffering, is the guarantee that the mass movement will expand and flourish. No one knows when, no one knows how. The future movement may not even resemble Occupy. It may not even bear the name Occupy, but it will continue. And then he goes on to suggest that we should use this time now to prepare to educate ourselves about the best ways to fight back, to learn from our mistakes. The folks at Occupy Wall Street in New York, where we were active in Washington, D.C., at Occupy Washington, D.C., or at Freedom Plaza, both occupations there in the nation's capital. Or we spoke to, I remember speaking to a fellow from Occupy Philadelphia, Occupy Pensacola, Florida. Occupy is everywhere. We need to be using this time to prepare and to learn from our mistakes that we've made over the last year and better ourselves and better the movement. I went on to write my piece more about the fact that Occupy is simply an idea. It is a tactic. It is a means to a final end. What that final end is, I mean, if you had to say it in one sentence, I would boil it down to the most good for the most amount of people, period. But
it's common good.
Common good, but yeah. Way more, you know, obviously complex than that. You know, how do we go about achieving that? And I wrote the piece, so I don't want to say any more than that. I want to kind of tease it. And so you can go read it and check it out. It's on filterfreeradio.com and usaprogressive.com and soon to be on fourfreedomsblog.com. And check back every week because I'm going to be putting up a new piece.
Nice.
You know, and the article goes on, as Chris Hedges does. That was more or less my main point on that. And Scott, did you want to add anything before we move on to how the corruption in possibly the NBA finals is similar to the corruption in the political system?
Yeah, absolutely. Before we dig into that, I mean, the whole point, I think, of his article and I think what we've been trying to express on this show for quite some time is the need to build, you know, pockets of resistance so that when, you know, when we reach this threshold of where everybody... Here's my thing, man. As we all know, since 2008, the economy has not gotten any better. And in fact, you know, if you listen to or read any sort of economist's view, it's apparent that whatever sort of stimulus came from the so-called stimulus, if you will, is over. And any kind of minute recovery that they were espousing is gone. And you can read this in the business sections of any paper. They're no longer talking about job creation. They're just talking about how we can, maintain where we are without sliding too far back. Or the fact that things are actually continually getting worse rather than better. And so the important thing to remember is, as we've said before, things are going to get worse before they get better. And they really almost have to because not enough people are hurting. And it's a real crass thing to say.
Darkest before the dawn.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's 5 years now. We're literally, you know, Japan, when they had this similar crisis, they had what they call a lost decade. We're halfway through our lost decade because the government did nothing about it. And that's where we are. The government's doing nothing about it. And the private sector is doing nothing about it except for getting wealthier and grabbing as much money as they can. And the people who know how fucked up things really are the ones on Wall Street and the banks. And they're grabbing as much money as they can before the shit hits the fan, because they know they need to have a little nice nest egg for when we return into some sort of Weimar Republic or whatever, and they have their gated communities and their money and things so they can sustain themselves during this drastic crisis. And so the important thing to remember for us, since we're not in the 1%, is to build communities, to build enclaves of individuals and groups where we're actually able to voice dissent and discuss what is really going on and discuss solutions and actually, you know, work on alternatives to what is otherwise considered our only option. I mean, the fact that capitalism is what all everybody thinks about. How do we fix capitalism? How do we fix, they don't even say it in those terms, they say, how do we fix the economy without actually talking about the corruption that lies within it. You know, it's sort of, if we just raise taxes on the rich, if we just brought jobs back from overseas with tariffs or blah, 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 blah. And there's so many layers of things wrong that it's obviously it's systemic. And the whole notion of leaving the same system in place that got us to this point by just adding a few laws or regulations or even enforcing the ones that are on the books. And let's face it, Ronald Reagan stopped enforcing the Sherman Antitrust Act 30 years ago, and it still hasn't been enforced. And so that's how come we have four major corporations own all the media outlets. And so the important thing is for all of us to come together, develop places and communities that we can sit around and discuss and learn. And that's what I think we're doing on this show here. And it's our goal is to have guests on who are activists and to get involved and explain to people what the solutions are and how they can get involved and how they can begin to fight back. Because there's going to come a time soon, and a lot of economists think it's going to happen before the election this fall, because I guess historically that is how it happened. In fact, 2008, the crash of 2008.
Right.
So, merely 4 years ago at this point, going on 5 years. In order to give people, because there's, in establishing these enclaves and these groups, and that's sort of what Occupy was able to do, was give people a space to go and say, for lack of a better term, it's a support group. And rather than them withdrawing in front of their televisions, watching Fox News for answers and searching for a demagogue, because when you're not prepared emotionally, intellectually, or psychologically to face the tragedy that befronts us, and you don't expect it, you don't anticipate it, and you ignore it, well, then when it hits you and you can no longer ignore it, you don't know what to do.
Yeah.
And you become really, really destitute. And so I think what we should do, and one of the main things to do again is to have these communities. So because what will happen is, as you'll see, I mean, I don't know how many people are listening right now because I can't be in a chat room. My computer will crash. But 10 or 15 people, whatever, at one point able to sit around and have these kinds of discussions. When this shit really does hit the fan, there's going to be hundreds and thousands of people looking for solutions and looking for alternatives and looking for support and understanding. And we have to be there to provide them and say, hey, look, I've been saying this for 2 years now. I'm sorry you're suffering, but I'm glad to see you finally see the writing on the wall. To use your metaphor.
Bam.
And so, yeah. And so see how you do, that's my whole thing.
You see how you plug that right there? That's
yeah, and it all comes back full circle. Bam. Because the shit is on the wall, man. People are either ignoring it or deluding themselves from it.
Here's
but it'll become a point where they can't ignore it anymore.
Here's the thing. If everyone would just, kind of remove their bare asses from crapping directly into the fan as it's circulated throughout the entire space, if we could stop that, I think then we could be able to clean up the mess, but I don't know.
I'm not sure what that analogy is.
Did that go too far? Is that where I crossed the line? Okay.
I think so, a little bit, yeah.
Okay. moving on, really quick, you brought up something, Scott, actually not necessarily topic-wise, but with your choice of words, and I loved it. I totally forgot to play something at the beginning of this program that I'm going to play from now on at the beginning of every program. It's a little disclaimer, and might as well play it now, better late than never, and give us a quick 20-second transition into our next topic. We're going to talk about the NBA Finals and the political system. Are they both rigged?
Warning, the following program contains actual facts, solutions, news, and information not heard in filtered media outlets. The discussion of such issues, truth, and reality may make you uneasy. Here, minds speak freely, unfiltered, and call bull where it must be called. Oh yeah, the language is filter-free too. Viewer discretion is advised.
I thought that was kind of badass. Thank you, official announcer man of Filter-Free Radio, Kenny Pick, host of Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
What a great voice.
I love it. I love it.
I love his voice, yeah.
So you may or may not know that something in basketball happened last week because everyone's been running around saying LeBron James got his rings. maybe you've heard that.
Who cares?
Maybe you have no idea what that means. I want to talk just for a couple of minutes before we get David Swanson on the program. I'm so excited. He'll be with us here in about 10 minutes. How
the NBA Finals, and I drew out an analogy. Scott and I were talking before the show. I drew out an analogy with the NBA Finals and the political system. And we were talking before the show, and he totally took it and ran with it and took it another step further. And that's why I want to share this conversation with you. That was awesome what you had added to that, Scott, by the way. energy! Yeah, okay. And so what happened in the NBA Finals, in my opinion, if I can explain it really quickly for you, if you have no idea what's going on, there are two teams and they're playing for the championship of the whole year. And it's the biggest game in the sport in this country. And for what that's worth, there's basically two teams. In this particular championship, there's two teams. It's your typical David and Goliath story. You've got the underdog of the team, which was just in Seattle. They used to be the Seattle Supersonics a couple of years ago. They didn't even exist in Oklahoma City. A complete, you know, fairy tale storyline of the team that no one expected, even though they were like kicking ass all year long. If anyone was,
actually, they had the best record in the league for most of the year. They were passed by the Spurs at the end of the year, but yeah, they were still the underdog in the finals.
And how about that? First of all, that's an interesting twist on the storyline. You're right about that, Scott, if you've been following that. And but no one expected them to really make it to the finals. I don't think it was. Everyone was expecting the San Antonio team to win. And faced the Miami team, which everyone expected to win. Why, on the other side, which is the East Coast side, why did everyone expect Miami to win? Well, simply, if you know anything about basketball, or if you know anything about the Miami Heat, or you know anything about LeBron James, if that name sounds familiar, he's basically, I don't know, the Michael Jordan of today, arguably the best player in the league, and has just been recently bought by the Miami Heat a couple of years ago to add to their superstar lineup. They made it to the NBA Finals, I believe, last year and lost to the Dallas Mavericks. I think that was what happened. But
that's correct.
The point is you have the underdog, the one who, I don't really follow basketball that intensely. I know a little bit here and there just because I catch things here and there on the news and whatnot. But and I'm a Portland Trail Blazer fan. I will admit that. I'm biased to the Blazers. Rip City. But the kind of point here is this Miami team bought LeBron James a couple of years ago. He's the best player in the league. Cost him a lot of money. A lot of money. And they have two other NBA All-Stars, you know, basically three of the best players in the league, arguably, in some respects. All with really high-paid salaries. They basically have the best team money can buy, you could argue, in the NBA right now. The best team money can buy. And, you know, if you're not really a sports fan, but you watch sports, I tend to always want to vote for the underdog because that just makes me feel good, you know. In my heart, my morals, I get some weird, like, conscious thing going on, and I want to vote for the underdog because that feels right for some reason. I don't know. You may disagree, but
When you don't have a dog in the fight, the underdog's who you root for.
Right. And I kind of like that, and so I wanted the underdogs to win, and I was kind of cheering for them, but in the back of my mind, I knew all along, because I am aware, at least for the most part, minus the last 2 weeks, of what's been going on in current events, I am aware of the similar predicaments going on in other systems where you see whoever has the most money wins. We played the promo on the last break, the new promo from, pardon me, Nicole Sandler, just getting over a cold if you're just joining us. Pardon my voice. That's not your computer speakers. That's me. we're talking about NBA here. And just for a couple of minutes, David Swanson's going to be up in just a couple of minutes. And also how Dylan Radigan, we played the promo over the break, he talks about elections. Elections aren't really elections. They are auctions that the person, the candidate, the side that spends the most money wins 94% of the time. I don't know what that statistic is in the NBA as far as what teams spend the most money on players and have championships. Probably not as high as 94%. I don't know. Maybe it is. But the point is that's definitely the case in the political system. How rigged is that? I brought that up to Scott before the show. And Scott, you ran with it from there.
My argument was that, Miami's the best team money can buy, and they have the best players in the league because of the money they spent on it. And so, but the narrative, I mean, the corporate narrative, the public narrative, the media's narrative is, oh, this is, it's all about LeBron. It's all about Miami's, expect, you know, what a great, glorious victory for them and so on and so forth. And my whole thing, because I watched every single game, and it was just painful for me to watch because I'm obviously rooting against Miami, and I love basketball. It was just sort of, you know, not a very good series, not very well played, but most of all, it seemed like it was fixed. I mean, I'm reminding myself of why I stopped watching the NBA years ago is because, you know, when you're watching these certain games and LeBron gets all the calls, and then there's a shift in the game where at one point, I know in game five, at one point, this just demoralized the Oklahoma City Thunder. They were up by 15 or 16 points in the first half. Then all of a sudden, Miami started getting really physical. And not only were they just playing dirty, but they were also getting the calls. And so at that point, you realize that even though you're up by 16 points, you're actually fighting not only the opposing team, but you're fighting the refs and their dirty play as well. And then you just get demoralized. And that pretty much was the turning point in the series. That second quarter in game four right there, they were never the same. They never, and that was it. They lost the next game, the next one, the series was over. And it just seemed to me that it was fixed because you hear all the announcers, you hear all the ESPN. I mean, Christ. ESPN, the day after that the Miami won, ran a full-hour special on the history of LeBron's career and how he got to be this great, glorious point. I'm like, how long did you have that one in the can waiting to play that one? You know, God forbid he shouldn't win.
Don't you?
You got to, you know. So it seems to me that the whole corporate media was just set up waiting for this narrative to finish its play out so they could just run with it and continue their media onslaught and fill time, fill airspace, you know. And so it just not only was the team itself, you know, I guess the best team money can buy, but the system seemed quite rigged in their favor. And that just speaks volumes to our society as a whole with corporate America. I mean, the media, I mean, you name every single aspect of our society, it's sort of rigged for those with money. And it works best for them and not so much for us. So.
Yep. We'll be right back. Sorry about the Skype noises here. Playing with the new studio, Mr. Skeptical Scott with us on filterfreeradio.com. We're live on radioornot.com. Standing by with us and coming up in just 5 minutes, we'll be speaking with author, blogger, and activist David Swanson, davidswanson.org. Don't go anywhere, ladies and gentlemen. You do not want to miss this conversation coming up next on Filter Free Radio.
Never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to the Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Bill Maher, you're here in Miami on Friday night. You're doing a show at the Fillmore at the Jackie Gleason Theater. They just renamed this theater the Fillmore.
Oh.
And they put up a couple of psychedelic posters. So I guess...
Is it the theater Jackie did his TV show for?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
What I hear they did is put up two of those old Bill Graham posters and renamed it.
Yeah, I can't think of two different icons of show business.
Yeah, really.
Bill Graham and Jackie Gleason.
Yeah, why they just didn't play up the Jackie Gleason aspect, I don't know. But then again, this is South Florida.
Right. Okay.
Welcome to it.
I feel warm.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at radioornot.com.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
You're listening to Win
the Workers' Independent News Service. I'm Jesse Russell. In a first for Connecticut, the New Haven Federation of Teachers will take over the running of a city high school as part of the city's ongoing school reform efforts. The arrangement may be unique in the country. Linda Tuhus reports.
High School in the Community, or HSC, was deemed a Tier 3 school, meaning it was among the lowest performing in the New Haven district. It was opened in the 1970s as a teacher-led school with a teacher facilitator instead of a principal, but those in charge still had to report to the superintendent. New Haven School Superintendent Reginald Mayo touted the cooperation between his administration and the New Haven Federation of Teachers since a landmark union contract was reached in 2009. Teachers Union President Dave Ciccarella said the contract allows heads of turnaround schools more discretion in staffing. In this case, it's the union itself that will decide which teachers will stay and which will be assigned to other schools. Turnaround schools also have longer school days and receive some additional support through the city. He said the students who return in the fall will see some changes.
They'll see some new faces, that's for sure. Many of the staff have been retained as well. But they're also going to see a different curriculum, some new courses, some changes into the way we do things to keep them at the center and at the focus of what we do here.
The new theme is law and social justice. New Haven, as one of the 30 lowest performing districts in the state, may be invited to apply for up to $2 million in additional state funding as part of Connecticut's just-passed education reform initiative. Although there are five other turnaround schools in the district, Superintendent Mayo and Ciccarella said if New Haven is chosen, the funds will go to HSC. State Senator Tony Harp of New Haven said when legislators were working on the state's education reform package, they left out something important to New Haven.
And that is showing that the teacher union, if it wants to, can actually run a school and can show the way in which it runs the school actually makes a difference.
So she made sure that got into the implementer bill that was passed in this month's special session. She added,
we're going to push in every way that we can that the extra resources come here so that you can prove that teachers should be valued, and when they are, they make a difference.
The third time is not a charm for locked-out American Crystal Sugar employees. On Saturday, the workers voted down the company's third contract offer, ensuring the 11-month dispute will continue. The union has said the workers aren't unhappy with the company's wage proposals, and the primary disconnect is over proposals to seniority, qualifications for promotion, and health care. Workers have alleged that the company's goal is to break the union.
You've been listening to WIN, the Workers' Independent News. For more information, visit laborradio.org.
Unfiltered truth, news, and opinion. Filter-free radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
How do you impart upon somebody the disconnect or what's otherwise known as hypocrisy that people have, that they deny themselves from? You know, they live in denial and live in the illusion.
You can't tell somebody they're wrong. They have to see it themselves.
Yeah, they have to discover for themselves how to think that way. So how do you plant the infection?
Filter-free radio, Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. Radio or not, and filterfreeradio.com.
Never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to The Nicole Sandler Show at RadioOrNot.com.
Bill Maher, you're here in Miami on Friday night. You're doing a show at the Fillmore at the Jackie Gleason Theater. They just renamed this theater the Fillmore.
Oh.
And they put up a couple of psychedelic posters. So I guess...
Was it the theater Jackie did his TV show for?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
What I hear they did is put up two of those old Bill Graham posters and renamed it.
Yeah, I can't think of two different icons of show business.
Yeah, really.
Bill Graham and Jackie Gleason.
Yeah, why they just didn't play up the Jackie Gleason aspect, I don't know. But then again, this is South Florida.
Right. Okay.
Welcome to it.
I feel warm.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at RadioOrNot.com.
The More Me Show, with DJ Downtown and Eddie Herradura, live from our nation's capital, every Sunday at 5 p.m. Eastern, with hilariously scathing inches from the beltway analysis of this week's political and social developments. The More Me Show at ProgressiveBlendRadio.com and RadioOrNot.com.
Looking for filters? Check your coffee maker. This is Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott. FilterFreeRadio.com. Get ready to suck down some grounds.
When I talk about resistance, I think we have to stand up now and carry out acts of nonviolent resistance.
Because the truth is, we do have power.
We live in revolutionary times, but the counter-revolution is winning.
Sounds like a case of the Monday.
Live every Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern, Filter Free Radio.
This is my favorite show.
We have been given an opportunity to make a new beginning.
I think it's very important for us to start to build a culture of resistance because what we're doing isn't working, clearly.
It's our job to very coldly assess reality and then figure out how to respond.
Your number one source for unfiltered truth, analysis, and solutions. FilterFreeRadio.com.
And welcome back to Filter Free Radio, proudly broadcasting live from Portland, Oregon on the West Coast. By my side, my co-host, live from Washington, D.C., on the East Coast, Skeptical Scott. We are joined by a very special guest broadcasting here live on RadioOrNot.com, ProgressiveBlendRadio.com, and, of course, our website, FilterFreeRadio.com. He is an author of several books, including Daybreak, Undoing the Imperial Presidency, and Forming a More Perfect Union, When, also another title, When the World Outlawed War, and also one of my favorites, War is a Lie. Of course, he's an activist. He's a blogger over at the websites warisacrime.org, rootsaction.org, and of course, his website is davidswanson.org, just like it sounds. David, it is so good to have you with us live on Filter Free Radio.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me on.
And, of course, with us, as I introduced David, you're also speaking with Scott here, who's also in Washington, D.C., I believe. And
that's correct.
Great, Scott. Thanks for being with us here, bud, as always. David, I just, first of all, wanted to say I'm a big fan of your work. Definitely, you do phenomenal work. When we were gearing up for the October 6, 2011 Occupy Freedom Plaza event in Washington, D.C., and we were talking about it on the air, we played some of the spots that you had done, you'd voiced for that, of course, in anticipation for that event, and we were definitely plugging that and talking it up, and it was great. We, Scott and I wasn't able to make it down there. Scott was able to make it down there that day and speak with Chris Hedges and a few other folks, and it's just great people doing great things, and I kind of wanted to lead off with how I'm got to really know you or know of you, David, and wanted you to kind of have an open floor here for the conversation for our audience. And in case if there's anyone out there who isn't familiar with you or your work, if you would care to just let a rip, that'd be great.
Well, I thought that occupation that we started back in October in Freedom Plaza was a wonderful thing. You know, some people commented, "Oh, you guys really had your finger on the pulse of the zeitgeist, that you knew this would be the time for occupation," which is absolute nonsense. I mean, we've been trying to occupy Washington, D.C. for years and years. You know, just finally got going last fall. And I think it was well timed in a number of ways, and the anti-war movement had a strong connection to the groups planning the occupation of Freedom Plaza, which of course had been in the planning long before anybody heard about occupying Wall Street. But it was Occupy Wall Street with a huge assist from the corporate media that created the Occupy movement and turned out the press and the energy and half the crowd for Freedom Plaza and for McPherson Square's occupation a few blocks away in the yep. same city. And all of these occupations all over the country, including here in Charlottesville. I actually live in Charlottesville, Virginia, which is a couple hours south of D.C. Sure. But, you know, it's a work that's still very much in progress. The Occupy movement is growing and expanding and maturing, and it's just not on television or in the newspapers. And this seems to me the biggest weakness we have at the moment is that, you know, good media outlets like this one have not yet seized control of people's consciousness from the corporate television networks and newspapers. And we ourselves talk about our movements as existing when they're on TV and not being there anymore when they aren't. And until we can overcome that and keep a movement going, even if the television created it in the first place, keep it going when the corporate media outlets turn against it and ignore it, we're pretty weak. And so there's a great deal of work to be done right now.
Absolutely. And Scott, feel free to jump in anytime you'd like, bud. That's more or less, David, the exact essence of the new blog that I wrote today over at filterfreeradio.com, and it's making its way around, that Occupy is simply a means. It's more of an idea. It's a tactic. And, of course, things like that will mature and change to become more relevant, more effective, and progress forward. And anyone who's saying, I had to write it because I just came back to Portland. I told the story a little bit earlier. I was having a friend with a conversation with a friend, and it got to the point where I was asking him if he knew anything about Occupy Portland, what was going on here locally. And he said, oh, isn't that over yet? Isn't that over with already? You know, I'm like, what? You know, I was kind of speechless. Even some of my good friends here in Portland can be a little disconnected from reality here. And, you know, how do we really reach out and hit the people that we need to hit when there's this gigantic corporate system out there only working for its best interests, and anything that is a threat to that, like an occupation movement, which, by the way, I love to point out, everyone forgets what happened to Occupy. It didn't go away. It was suppressed. It was choked out. It was intimidated and eventually made illegal in some places by some laws, some anti-protest laws. And it's kind of scary when it's getting to a point like that.
Well, I think the scariness is on both sides, clearly, because the crackdowns on civil liberties, the police brutality, the militarization of the police forces, the legalization of the use of the U.S. military in the United States as a police force, the legalization of baseless, lawless imprisonment and detention without charge, without process. I mean, this is all in great part a response out of fear on the part of our government. So people are afraid. People are afraid to turn out and protest, and the government uses that to every advantage. They've charged a handful of people with terrorism in Chicago coming out of the NATO protest, prior to which they were announcing possible evacuations of the city and all sorts of catastrophes to scare people away. But they're scared too. They're scared of us, and that's not our goal. But we sometimes don't realize our own strength. We don't realize the peace movement that we had back in 05 and 06 before the Democrats began to take over government and the peace movement began to demobilize in response, which of course is a stupid thing to do. And we don't realize the incredible power that has been building and was seriously threatening those in high office this past fall with the Occupy movement.
Scott, do you want to jump in, bud?
I do. I have a couple questions for you, actually, Dave. Since you're actually a grassroots activist and you're on the ground, you're able to actually see what's going on. One of the things we've espoused on this show is that we've already lost our democracy. Would you agree with that sentiment?
Well, we never had direct democracy in this country. We've in some ways been inching towards it and in other ways away from it. You saw the Supreme Court rule today. You know, for those who were imagining that the Citizens United decision was some sort of accident, or they didn't quite realize what the, you know, they went out of their way to rule in that original decision over 2 years ago. And there was no question that those five justices meant what they were doing, and they made that very clear today by telling the state of Montana, you cannot regulate or ban bribery in elections. I mean, there's no other way to put it. We have elections in this country that don't begin to approach legitimate standards for international observers. We don't have a credible way of counting votes in most counties. We don't have open, realistic access to become a candidate or to form a party or to even be registered to vote reliably in this country. And now we have this second ruling further strengthening this notion that you cannot limit outside corporate spending on elections, which is going to dominate the decisions in the presidential and congressional elections coming up, as 2 years ago. For the most part, whoever benefits the most from that spending is going to win. Between, of course, two outrageously horrendous candidates, which, you know, seems to be a practice that Egypt has now copied from us, much to our shame. Over the recent years and decades, we've been expanding who can vote. You know, we've expanded from rich white male landowners to, you know, everybody over 18, unless you've been convicted of a crime in certain states and so forth, theoretically can vote. But at the same time, it's been this awful joke in that we've stripped away what it means to vote. So that there was a time, a half century back, that it did mean a little bit more to go and vote. And as we've expanded the franchise, we've at the same time stripped away what it's worth. And so we go through this charade of voting, and it means less and less.
Yeah, that speaks to my next point that I wanted to raise and I wanted to ask you about. And that's the notion of ignoring the election cycle. You know, the elections are something that the Occupy movement and I would say activists in general need to continue to avoid, because it really is a distraction and a charade, as you say.
Well, I don't know. I don't know if I want to say simply ignore it, because I think that it helps to have elections. I don't think we can do without them, but I think, and these have been central among the demands of the Occupy movement from the start, and of course there have been demands, we need to radically reform the election process so that you can get names on the ballot, you can have the votes publicly counted by hand on paper, you can get candidates into debates and have legitimate free airtime, and you can get the private money out of the elections so that it's a question of support for policies rather than money buying the candidates. And I don't think we can push for those reforms while completely ignoring elections. But I think that we should radically downgrade their importance. I think that most of us should put 5% or less of our attention and resources and energy into elections. I think we should not fall for the lesser evilism. I think that you should back a legitimately good candidate, you know, not an outrageously evil candidate because someone else is even more evil. Because when most people do that, They don't just do it for that split second in the voting booth. They maintain that lesser evilism in their behavior throughout the year and begin to think of themselves as the cheering section for one of two teams in the government rather than a member of the public, taking our concerns uncensored to the government as a whole. And that's what's been fatal to our movements, is that the lesser evilism doesn't stop the day after the election. But when it comes to organizations and when it comes to big funding, I think a case could be made really for a shift to ignoring elections. I mean, the various progressive groups and constituencies, the labor movement alone, dumps enough money into every election cycle for this marginal difference between two evil candidates to create new television networks, new newspapers, new massively funded think tanks and organizations. I mean, there are many, many ways that those resources, and not to mention the time of endless volunteer hours going around registering people to vote, could be much better spent. I think the activism that is not strictly electoral, apart from elections, moving our policy demands on the government as a whole is far more important. And that's not new. You know, what's new is that people are failing to grasp that, asking, if you're not working on elections, how can you be serious? You know, just
I'm sorry. I was going to say, I think what exemplifies your argument there would be what happened in Wisconsin. I mean, we had an actual movement going, and then they were sort of co-opted into, campaigning for a Democrat. It just was completely futile.
Well, I agree, and we've seen it in Egypt, and we've seen it around the world and around the country for many decades. Elections can be deadly, and when you have popular demand that Democratic Party groups see as worth supporting, as you had a year ago in Wisconsin, then you have passionate energy plus resources and funding and the logistical ability to do something. I mean, this is what we had in 05, 06 nationally, and in Washington, we had a peace movement that lined up those who don't like wars with those who don't like Republican wars. And you had those two forces combined, and it was very, very powerful. But when you take that and you funnel all that energy into an election campaign for a candidate who doesn't give a damn about any of that and doesn't want anything to do with the movement or its original demands, and doesn't energize or excite people, and it all becomes about voting against one guy and in favor of somebody else that nobody even really cares that much about, and there's no credible way to count the votes, you put all your eggs and all your hopes and all your emotions into that basket, you're asking to be disappointed. If you're organizing for the future and you're educating and you're mobilizing and you're building a movement at the grassroots and in the media, then you can't go through such severe cycles of hope and disappointment.
If you're just...
Amen, brother.
Can I get an amen out there? If you're just joining us, we're speaking with David Swanson. He's an author, blogger, activist. Website, davidswanson.org, SWANSON.org, just like it sounds. And one of our favorite topics on Filter Free Radio, in just kind of generally speaking, but we can hone it in... to the specifics of what we're talking about right here, is simply solutions. What are we going to do about it? What should we be doing about it? What should, you know, your average Joe or average Jane, who isn't necessarily completely aware of everything going on, because, you know, we know they can't be. That's how it's so manipulated to be, is we're so busy with our lives, working so much harder, we can't really grasp everything out there that we need to be grasping. What do we need to be doing? What could be a solution? And my apologies. I thought that was an interesting topic to bring up because of your book, Daybreak, Undoing the Imperial Presidency and Forming a More Perfect Union. Sounds like a solutions book to me.
It is very much a solutions book, and it's a few years old, but still very much current, and few, if any, of the proposed solutions have been checked off the list yet. You know, in fact, additional problems have been added. But, you know, we've seen, just to take an example related to that book, we've seen just in recent days this burst of demand for congressional power and oversight and checks on executive abuses coming from Republicans in Congress. And we've seen this shift among the Democrats who objected to every power abuse by Bush and Cheney to accepting essentially more power than King George III ever had when these colonies fought a revolution against him, as long as it's Obama who has those powers for the moment, knowing, of course, that there will be Republicans coming down the line. And this is where we have to change our thinking as well as the behavior in Congress. I mean, when we were trying to impeach Bush and Cheney, and people said, oh, you just don't like them because he talks funny with bad grammar, or he's a Republican, or he's from Texas. You don't like him. You want to kill him. You know, and we would say, no, listen, honest to God, I don't want to kill anybody. I don't dislike anybody. But if you let George W. Bush put those powers into the White House, the next person of whatever party, of whatever gender, is going to have those powers and add to them. And if you let him or her get away with that, the Supreme Court is going to treat those powers as officially part of the presidential power basket now, and it's going to be virtually impossible to take them away. And so you had George W. Bush largely establish, it was still somewhat illicit and scandalous, the powers to spy without warrant and imprison without charge and torture and abuse and rendition and fight illegal wars and launch illegal secretive strikes and so forth. And then you had, while you had the Republicans all defending that as absolutely righteous, and then you had Barack Obama come in as expected, as predicted, as in line with what every previous president has ever done, and accept and build on those powers and formalize them and make them acceptable and put them down in executive orders and in congressional legislation and move beyond them to wide open public assassination programs and drone wars on a massive scale with the Democrats leading the charge, cheering, from lawyers like Harold Coe and that gang to ordinary people on the street, with Republicans all of a sudden claiming that Congress should have powers and the executive is getting imperial and so forth, even while on the big things, the Republicans in Congress want Obama to, and everybody in, who comes after him to have these powers, and they're just going after him on relatively minor offenses. But we should stop thinking like that. You know, we should actually care whether a single individual has these powers or Congress does, at the same time that we have to care whether Congress represents us at all or represents the people who buy it. Because the one thing those rich white male landowners got right, who put this country together, was that you can't give a single person powers or he will abuse them and you will have endless wars. And so, you know, much as I like people like Jill Stein and Rocky Anderson who are running for president, and much as I think we should back them, you know, a good, progressive, benevolent dictator is not ultimately the solution. You know, we have to elect someone who is going to rid the presidency of those powers, and that's going to take an absolute saint.
David, it's a pleasure speaking with you. Would you like to stick around for a few more minutes and continue the conversation? Or if you have to go, that's quite all right.
I can do a few more minutes.
Yeah, that sounds great. I'd love to maybe put a little wrap on this conversation, come back, and also I want to talk, because you talk about endless war. I also see, of course, you know, the new book that you've been editing and working on that just came out, The Military Industrial Complex at 50, a collection of work. Maybe we could talk about that for a minute and get your thoughts on it, get Scott's thoughts on it, and we'll be right back. Don't go anywhere. FilterFreeRadio.com, RadioOrNot.com, ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Check out David Swanson's website, davidswanson.org, for more information on David. We'll be right back on Filter Free Radio.
Unfiltered truth, news, and opinion. Filter Free Radio with Jacob Dean and Skeptical Scott.
How do you impart upon somebody the disconnect, or what's otherwise known as hypocrisy, that people have, that they deny themselves from? You know, they live in denial and live in the illusion.
You can't tell somebody they're wrong. They have to see it themselves.
Yeah, they have to discover for themselves how to think that way. So how do you plant the inception?
Filter Free Radio, Monday, 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. Radio or not, and filterfreeradio.com.
You're listening to WIN, the Workers' Independent News Service. I'm Jesse Russell. In a first for Connecticut, the New Haven Federation of Teachers will take over the running of a city high school as part of the city's ongoing school reform efforts. The arrangement may be unique in the country. Linda Tuhus reports.
High school in the community, or HSC, was deemed a Tier 3 school, meaning it was among the lowest performing in the New Haven district. It was opened in the 1970s as a teacher-led school with a teacher facilitator instead of a principal, but those in charge still had to report to the superintendent. New Haven School Superintendent Reginald Mayo touted the cooperation between his administration and the New Haven Federation of Teachers since a landmark union contract was reached in 2009. Teachers Union President Dave Ciccarella said the contract allows heads of turnaround schools more discretion in staffing. In this case, it's the union itself that will decide which teachers will stay and which will be assigned to other schools. Turnaround schools also have longer school days and receive some additional support through the city. He said the students who return in the fall will see some changes.
They'll see some new faces, that's for sure. Many of staff have been retained as well. But they're also going to see a different curriculum, some new courses, you know, some changes into the way we do things to keep them at the center and at the focus of what we do here.
The new theme is law and social justice. New Haven, as one of the 30 lowest performing districts in the state, may be invited to apply for up to $2 million in additional state funding as part of Connecticut's just passed education reform initiative. Although there are five other turnaround schools in the district, Superintendent Mayo and Ciccarella said if New Haven is chosen, the funds will go to HSC. State Senator Tony Harp of New Haven said when legislators were working on the state's education reform package, they left out something important to New Haven.
And that is showing that the teacher union, if it wants to, can actually run a school and can show the way in which it runs the school actually makes a difference.
So she made sure that got into the implementer bill that was passed in this month's special session. She added,
we're going to push in every way that we can that the extra resources come here so that you can prove that teachers should be valued, and when they are, they make a difference.
The third time is not a charm for locked-out American Crystal Sugar employees. On Saturday, the workers voted down the company's third contract offer, ensuring the 11-month dispute will continue. The union has said the workers aren't unhappy with the company's wage proposals, and the primary disconnect is over proposals to seniority, qualifications for promotion, and health care. Workers have alleged that the company's goal is to break the union.
You've been listening to WIN, the Workers' Independent News. For more information, visit laborradio.org.
You never know who or what you'll hear when you listen to The Nicole Sandler Show at radioornot.com.
Greg Palast, I realized as we were talking that actually we were supposed to do this on Wednesday, so thank you so much for bearing with me.
Well, I am thrilled that we're doing that. You jumped the other characters. Because, Nicole, I just think that your show is brilliant. And I want to thank you, because my stuff may be prime time in Britain, but here I keep slamming into the electronic Berlin Wall, and you have snuck me across and into the information stream. And I hope that your listeners are aware of how important and precious your program is. So I want to thank you.
The Nicole Sandler Show, live Monday through Thursdays at 10 a.m. Eastern, or podcast anytime at radioornot.com.
Here comes Jacob Dean on your computer screen with Skeptical Scott, whether you like it or not, on Radio or Not, and filterfreeradio.com. Revolution solution.
Welcome back to Filter Free Radio, proudly broadcasting live from Portland, Oregon, on RadioOrNot.com, ProgressiveBlendRadio.com, and FilterFreeRadio.com. And with us, we've been speaking with this last half an hour, and we only have him for a couple more minutes. It's getting late on the East Coast. And thanks again, David, for being with us. He is, of course, the blogger, activist, author, David Swanson, davidswanson.org. Also, check out War is a Crime. .org, just as it sounds, and Roots, R-O-O-T-S, action.org for more information. David, thanks again for coming on with us.
Great to be here.
And I just wanted to kind of wrap up the conversation with a brief touch on this new piece of work that's come out that you've been working on. And do you want to tell us about that a little bit, David? And get into that, the military-industrial complex at 50.
Well, it's a reference to the speech that President Eisenhower gave on his way out of office now 51 years ago. Yeah. And this was the result of a conference that we put together here in Charlottesville, Virginia, bringing experts from around the country and outside it to talk about what the military-industrial complex has become in all of these years. And it's become a major part of our economy. It eats up over half of federal discretionary spending to the detriment of everything else. It's the reason that our nation is wealthier than many others, but less well off by many measures in terms of education, environmental sustainability, health, life expectancy, infant mortality, et cetera, et cetera. And we brought together people who look at what the military-industrial complex does to civil liberties, what it does to education, to poverty, to the natural environment, the military itself, of course, being the world's biggest consumer of the oil that it fights the wars over, and every other area of our life and our public policy. And if we were able to bring the forces of these organizations together, we could turn the thing around. If the big environmental groups would take on their number one opponent, if the big civil liberties groups wouldn't just fight off torture and imprisonment and each abuse, but the military spending, and so forth across the board. If we could unite the movements that need the money with the movement that knows where the money is going but shouldn't be, we would have a coalition that could turn this ship around. As it is, we don't have that, and we have a political party that wants to, you know, cut taxes more on billionaires and fund lots of wars, and a political party that wants to tax the billionaires a little bit more and fund lots of wars. And it's, we don't have it in the debate.
The last question, and again, thanks, David, for coming on. Check out his website, davidswanson.org, for more information. To someone who's never heard this show or heard of you or me, and we just totally spoke to and touched on a level that they want to run out tomorrow and get active in a minute or so, what would you tell them to do, David?
Well, go to rootsaction.org for my example of an online activist group, but there are dozens and there are links there to others. Go to good blogs and websites. Go to warisacrime.org and link to other sites and organizations. Learn to find good information that you won't find on your television or usually on your radio. With the exception of good shows like this that are largely on the internet, and get active with local groups in person. There are peace and justice organizations in your town. There are clubs, there are meetups, and if there aren't, you can start one. But get active both online and personally face-to-face, and don't underestimate the difference that it makes, which sometimes you don't see right away, but it always does make a difference.
Absolutely. David Swanson, author, blogger, activist, davidswanson.org. It's a pleasure speaking with you, and we look forward to having you on again soon, David.
My pleasure. Thank you.
All right. Have a good night, David. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Wow. How about them apples for a comeback show on Filter Free Radio, Mr. Skeptical Scott?
I love it. I want to talk to him for hours. Okay. I have much more questions.
And I mean, I'm so happy that we got to talk to David tonight. I mean, he's touching on so many things that I want to talk about, topics, you know, and a couple of plugs. I mean, that's awesome. It's so important to check out your local, or not necessarily local, but at least independent media sources, because don't forget that the, you know, the corporate owned and controlled media out there, the ones with the biggest microphones and the ones that everyone listens to and hears, the purpose of their existence is to serve their own interests above all and totally keep us distracted from the real issues. You know, they want us to debate the left versus the right or Obama versus Romney, which betters their ratings, it betters their profit, and while in the meantime, we're completely ignoring the unmatched assault by corporate power on we the people. The writing is on the wall.
Amen, brother.
Yeah.
I like to refer to them as Obomny.
Obomny.
That's just my I misspoke one time because I was talking too fast. I'm like, Obomny. That's what it is. That's what it is, Obomny. It's all the same. Just Obomny. One big word. That's just... Yeah, it just all runs together. And he really touched on some good things and that gave me some ideas there at the end. I really, you know, that I didn't even consider that there's actual local peace activist groups to get involved with, because it does start on the local level. All resistance is local.
Yeah.
And you have to begin to form groups and coalitions, and it's like I said, it's a support group. You know, if nothing else, you're actually out there physically meeting people. And I love being online with everybody, and I love doing the radio show. But it is important to actually be in the physical presence of other people and talking with them and experiencing what they have to share. And so I think I need myself to look up some local groups in our area here and go down and see what they're talking about and what they're organizing for. Because there's not enough resistance, and we need to get out there and start resisting.
If I'm speaking to anyone who's also in Portland, Portland, Oregon, check out Occupy Portland, which I'm really excited to get back. You know, once all of the dust is settled, and I look forward to getting, you know, active again as much as I can with the movement here. Get over this cold. OccupyPortland.org, things like that. You know, you read on their website, all they say is, you know, visit us. They have an office near downtown. It's on 11th and Oak. And daily events can be found, OccupyPortlandCalendar.org. Participate. Join in a meeting. Spokes Council meets every Thursday. General Assemblies are Sunday. I mean, and when I went to the Occupy Portland website and I read that, and it's, you know, look how active they are. They've got 3 or 4 brand new articles that just came up this week about Occupy, the summer events going on, taking place now, at least here locally in Portland. Check out your local Occupy. See what's going on. I mean, the point here is it's a means. It's not an ends. It's a tactic. It was an idea to get us motivated and get us aware and make some, at least, local connections, and like you said, Scott, get out there and actually be with people and communicate and conversate and interact and build alliances, build awareness, build knowledge. I mean, knowledge is power, and this is grassroots activism, bottom up, 101, you know?
Yeah.
And
I mean, the question is not, how do we get good people to rule? That is the wrong question. Most people who seek power are weak, or, you know, or which is Obama, or venal, which is Bush. You know, they're all both very mediocre. Yep. The question is, how do we make those in power more afraid of us than they are of the very wealthy and corporations?
Bingo.
And so we have to put pressure on our elected officials. I mean, my struggle is, do we just bring the entire system down and have a revolution, which a nonviolent one, of course, which I guess there are a few examples out there. But Great Britain is arguably one of them. And then the other one would be, or do we just form enough? I mean, the goal obviously is to recreate socialism as a viable political force.
Sure.
And to have that narrative of the greater good. I mean, God, whatever happened to we'll do this because it serves the greater good.
Right.
That's a phrase you never hear anymore.
Yeah. Someone asked me, I was having a conversation with, actually, I'll announce it again one more time. Happy birthday, Carmen, my sweetheart out there who's in the chat room hanging out. We were having a birthday dinner with some of Carmen's family, and we were talking afterwards, brought up the idea. Oh, well, I mean, what is your solution? I mean, I'm like, I like to talk about solutions. He's like, well, what's your solution? I'm like, well, to put it in one word or one sentence, it's the most good for the most amount of people. And I mean, that's obviously as simple, as simplistic as it can get, the point, the idea. But, and you can break it down in however you'd like. And one of the things that David Swanson just touched on, or a little bit earlier in our conversation, was, you know, put their aces in their places. If you've ever worked in management in food service, you might know that saying, put your aces in their places. So you put your, you know, environmental activists in the most effective situations that they can be in, and you put your political activists in the most significant and relevant situations that they can be in. You put your best...
Can you play that one clip from Derek Jensen? Do you have that?
Maybe.
Do you have options? can you play some clips?
Well,
the reason I bring it up is because one of the things he says is, and there's a lot of people who have said this, it's just sort of, you know, when you ask, what do you do? What are the solutions? And the first question is always, what do you love? What are you good at? What kind of skills do you have that are unique to you and all the universe?
I'll play the clip in just a second.
Don't ruin it for everybody.
Don't say it.
All right. My point is that the questions start from within.
Right.
You have to start asking yourself, what can I do? What do I like to do? I like talking. So being on a talk radio show is great. I get to express all these things that I've learned over the past years, and I mean, I read a lot, you know, and I listen to a lot of lectures. And if you go to my video blog, I put up a whole bunch of new stuff that I've been listening to and learning about recently with Slavoj Žižek and people like Chalmers Johnson and all these historians.
Let's play this Derek Jensen clip, and then we'll come back and we'll talk about that video and the conversation we briefly teased earlier about how, you know, how come the only voice of discontent on the left is coming from the right wing. You know, what's up with that? Yeah. How's that sound?
Go for it.
Okay. Here you go, bud.
What do you love? What are your gifts? And what is the largest, most pressing problem that you can help to solve using the gifts that are unique to you and all the universe? What does your land base need to survive? And are you willing to do it?
Bam. How about them apples? I mean, that's so short. It's only 15 seconds. You want to hear that again, just in case anyone missed anything?
Yeah, okay.
This is good stuff. Listen to this.
What do you love? What are your gifts? And what is the largest, most pressing problem that you can help to solve using the gifts that are unique to you and all the universe? What does your land base need to survive? And are you willing to do it?
There you go. Derek Jensen. Good stuff.
I love it.
Thank you for reminding me to play that, Scott. That's what super duper mass producer, awesome, kick-ass co-host does.
Yeah, it'd be a lot easier if we're sitting in the same room and I could be like, hey, man.
Yeah.
I gotta get my computer set up so I can play, have my own box and play some drops and stuff.
Oh, yeah. Of course, bear with us as we more or less rebuild the configuration of Filter Free Radio again, but it's pretty cool. And so far, I'm seeing some pretty good feedback out there. I think we're doing okay.
All right. Sound all right? As long as we sound good, it's the most important.
All right.
I don't have a box to play with, so to speak, but there'll be, you know.
I spent the last 2 weeks working on the studio just for shits and giggles. But Scott, and we
weren't just completely slacking. That's why we weren't doing a show.
No, well, life happened, and when you move across the country and all of your stuff moves across the country, that takes a week to do. And then when you've got things going on at home that you've come home to deal with, that takes a week to do. And then when you work too hard on your studio and all of the above, you get burnout and you get sick. That takes a week to get over. And so about 3 or 4 weeks into the move, we're ready to get back on the air. I thought that was funny. You're not laughing, Scott. I'm not that funny, am I? I think I'm funny.
You're sick. You still sound sick, though.
Yeah, my apologies. Bear with us. That is not your computer speakers. That's my voice.
Skype.
Well, it sounds great on this end, and I'm sending it out from this end. So you sound great, Mr. Scott. And Will from Will from Chicago says, oh, yeah, levels are good. I'm just emphasizing that comment. We've got about 10 more minutes left in the broadcast, and I wanted to have us riff on this topic to kind of wrap it up, which was a really rather interesting topic, Scott, that you brought up. And I want you to kind of run with it here for a couple of minutes. And again, this comes from the philosopher Slavo Žižek. I think I said that okay, yep. Close.
Slavo Žižek.
Z-I-Z-E-K. The only voice of liberal discontent is the right wing, and people are really realizing that both parties on all sides, in every which way you look at it, are corrupt. And Scott, run with it.
Well, it just speaks to what we were talking about earlier, and that's the notion that people are on, you know, here's the argument that I hear from people. We have to support Obama because Romney's worse. Oh my God, if we don't go out and vote for Obama, we're going to get Romney, and then we're going to be really in trouble. Well, how much worse off are we going to be?
Yeah.
I mean, really, it's all bad. And so far, nothing's been done to fix anything in the last 4 years. In fact, it's obvious, if you're paying attention, things have gotten worse with the expansion of the drone wars. We don't even have habeas corpus. The passing of the NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act, which, as we know, Chris Hedges and others have sued Obama for, which you can watch the video on our webpage about that as well. And so things are getting worse. There's nothing being done domestically. All the money is being spent on our military. And if I may, indulge me for a second, I'd like to read a quick quote from Chalmers Johnson. Chalmers Johnson he recently passed away, but he was a historian who was adamant against the empire.
It's not Olong Johnson, is it?
No, it's Chalmers Johnson.
That was a South Park reference joke.
Boom.
Hey.
but anyway, you know, the quote is, "A nation can be one or the other, a democracy or an empire, but it cannot be both. If it sticks to imperialism, it will, like the old Roman Republic, on which much of our system was modeled, like the old Roman Republic, it will lose its democracy to a domestic dictatorship." And that's well documented. That's not just Chalmers Johnson. That's, you know, it's his quote. But that's
sure.
if you look at the Roman Republic, I mean, it was called the Roman Republic, and then it became an empire, and then it collapsed. And the same is true for a lot of other civilizations. You know, the Egyptians are one, and as well as the Mayans and things. You know, even modern day Russia, for that matter, and so that's the problem. I mean, 60% of our money is spent on war. We are an empire that is constantly at war.
Can I interrupt you for just a second?
Yeah, go for it.
One of the things I've been doing this past week, we were talking about working on the studio, is looking for posters or looking for things to put up in the studio behind me. And by the way, as you can see, there's a little bit of white space. If you're interested in possibly putting up an advertisement or something, or a promo, or like whatever you see fit or you suggest, or you got a poster, a political poster, or an inspirational poster, get in contact with us. Email us on our website, jacob@filterfreeradio.com, skeptical@filterfreeradio.com. Let us know. But one of the signs that I saw that really recently, a couple days ago, that sparked my interest, and you touched on, was it was at Poster Planet, and it said words to the effect of well, damn it, now I'm blanking on the poster. Oh, what did it say? Gosh dang it, I can't remember it now. I've seen about 24 different posters that I want to put up behind me, and I'm getting them mixed up now. Scott, what was your main point that you just made? Maybe it sparked my memory.
I could wrap that up and bring it full circle. Yeah. The point of that is that people are aware in some vague fashion, even those who aren't paying attention, that shit is fucked up and bullshit.
Yeah, shit is fucked up and bullshit.
Right. And so, but they don't know why. And so the only people out there who are explaining it to them is the right wing. Right wing will tell you why. It's because of liberals. The liberals, on the other hand, don't have a thing to say about it. You know, they're busy just refuting what right wing is doing or bashing them, you know, back and forth. They're not providing another narrative.
Absolutely not. Why would they?
Because they want to maintain their status quo. They both want to maintain their status quo, and that's how they argue with each other. And so what we have to do as a civilization, as society, as individuals, is to establish a third narrative, because there's a vacuum right now. And what happens when that vacuum is created and there's no explanations out there, something has to fill that vacuum. And that's how you get demagogues, and that's how you get fucking Nazi Germany, and that's how you get Mussolini, and that's how you get fascists like Fox News, what they call people call fascist shill news, going out there and explaining, oh, it's the immigrants. Oh, I can't tell you how many people think that we have an immigration problem. It's so irrelevant. You know, it's like voting. Oh my God, these people are voting illegally. Are you serious? I mean, there's just so many non-issues that are distracting people, and they're scapegoated. You know, and of course, gays are being scapegoated. And there's so many scapegoats that you have to get out there and tell some truth and tell some radical honesty and give people the truth so that they can decide, so that they know, oh my God, you know, really, this is how bad it is, and actually see for themselves what's going on. But unless there's someone out there to do it and to provide that third narrative, we're screwed.
Yeah.
You know, because it's going to be provided for us by corporate America, by the right wing, by the very wealthy elites who want to suppress all this kind of dissent. And so then the important thing is that to realize and acknowledge that everybody knows something's wrong. Nobody knows why or what to do about it. And so we have to get out there and engage people and say, immigration is not a problem. We have more people leaving the country now than we do going. Obama has deported more people in 3 years than George Bush did in 8.
Booyah.
It's not an issue. You know, but you don't know that because you're watching TV. You know, and there's nothing on TV. I swear to God, Jacob, you and I have come to the conclusion, and I've developed this to the point where the only television I watch that's news is The Daily Show and Colbert.
Jon Stewart.
Otherwise, I watch crap like The Simpsons or Family Guy, or I don't watch sports, or I don't watch the TV at all because there is no news.
Bingo.
on television. It's just garbage. It's propaganda. It's gossip. It's irrelevant nonsense. And so it's important to engage people and fill that vacuum with some sort of honesty. Otherwise, you know, we're fucked.
Well, on a much lighter note, and I agree, Scott, you're right. I would completely endorse a statement, words to the effect of, the only thing, in my opinion, Jacob Dean of Filter Free Radio, worth watching daily on TV is The Daily Show with Jon Stewart. Nothing else.
Oh, it's really good lately, man. Really good.
And so again, I'll extend the offer of, if anyone has any contributions as far as studio background is concerned, I totally feel like an ass because thanks to Snork Y2K, I realized I couldn't even spell occupy right on the sign behind me.
Oh my God, seriously?
And I want to tell you something really quick. That is a prime example of a curse from radio broadcasting school. You do not know how to spell anything if you take radio school. You simply know how to phonetically spell and pronounce. So for what that's worth, it's a funny little wrap-up to the show tonight. I want to just mention a couple of quick mentions before we go because we've got a couple of minutes.
Does it say O-C-C-U-Y?
Yeah. Hey, and I'm sick, too, so come on. The brain's only, like, functioning at, what, 80%? I don't know what the whatever.
You're missing a whole consonant, man. there's a lack of a syllable in that word. Jesus.
If you can't laugh at yourself, then you're not allowed to laugh at anyone else either. So there you go. How about them apples? It is so good to be back with you live. We will continue to be with you live. I, of course, live from Portland, Oregon on the West Coast. Scott, my awesome producer and co-host, will be joining us live from Washington, D.C. Scott, thanks again for being with us, bud. And as
happy
always,
to be here.
And special thanks to our special guest, author, blogger, activist David Swanson. Check out davidswanson.org. Special mentions, happy birthday, Carmen. And special thanks to Nicole Sandler of RadioOrNot.com and DJ Downtown of ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. All the folks who helped make this show possible. To you, the folks in the chat room, you are the reason we're doing this. Thank you. Keep up the good fight out there. To danosongs.com and the Roy Bird at crownrecords.com for music production. Subscribe to our free video podcasts on YouTube. Find us FFR with JD on YouTube. Filterfreeradio.com. We'll see you next Monday at 7 p.m. Eastern right here on Radio or Not.
This is it.
There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. And you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop.
So give me something to believe. 'Cause I ain't living for me.
Listening to Jacob Dean, streaming live on the web.
The revolution will be broadcast.
We bring you the real stuff.